So, having been journeying through the theme of repentance, we ask this morning, are you repentant? Are you repentant? There is God, and He is holy and altogether beautiful. And you must repent before Him. You say, why? Because He is your creator. You owe everything to Him. Your destiny is in His hands. And our sin keeps us from Him. We were designed to be for Him. Our sin keeps us away from Him. We need to repent. There is a hell. There is a place of everlasting pain and misery. A fearsome place. And you need to repent. Because if you don't repent, you will spend eternity in hell under the fearsome judgment of the eternal God with no escape and no deliverance. You need to repent. There is a world that is in a mess. There is a world which is hopeless in its mess. And you need to repent. Because you're a part of this world, and I'm a part of this world. We're a part of this confused mess, and it is all a mess because of sin. And I am a sinner. And I am a confused mess, and I need help. I need my sins forgiven, so I must repent. You must repent. We are sinners. We have sinned against God. We are set for the eternal judgment of God in hell, and we're in a world which is caught up in sin. And we must repent the realities of God and of hell and of this world and of ourselves cry out to us this morning. We must repent. God is real. Hell is real. This world is real. I am real. Sin is real. Cry out and say, we must repent. So are you repentant? Are you repentant? We must repent and believe the gospel. We declare a message of repentance towards God and faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. So are you repentant? Are you one who says, I am sorry, I have done wrong, please forgive me to the eternal God? The wrongness is before Him. The wrongness has eternal consequences. It's not some cheap sorry that we utter in day-to-day life. It's a statement of vast magnitude as we cry out for the mercy of God to be upon us in all of our sin. True repentance always leads us to faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. They always go together. That is what? That is a banana. A banana is made up of two parts, and they always go together. You have the skin and you have inside the edible white contents. You have to have both to have a banana. Neither can exist on its own. Salvation from God has repentance towards God and faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. And they go together. And for full and true salvation, you cannot have either on their own. The repentant one comes to faith in Jesus Christ, because in our brokenness, we see him in all of the fullness of the one who gave himself for us. Now in glory, having triumphed over death. And so we say, what was that statement about the road sign? Danger, wrong way, turn around. And we're not left in no man's land. We're not left in some sort of territory which is neutral. We are brought into salvation. So I say, repent towards God. Why do you make it so serious, Philip? Because it is serious, because it is repentance to flee from the wrath to come. But you come and you turn to the glorious salvation which is found in Jesus Christ, that eternal Savior who came into this world and took our sins, the beautiful Lord Jesus Christ, who went about doing good, his life full of grace and truth. His life ever pleasing to God. There is a man who has walked this scene and he's never put a foot wrong. And he came as the perfect one, proven through his life, to give his life as a one offering for our sins. And as we turn, he takes us into his sin cleansing arms. He touches us like he touched that leper of old who'd never been touched in years, and the leprosy went. And when we come and touch him by faith, our sin is cleansed. We're acceptable with God. The purpose of God is realized, that we are back in fellowship with him. And what are they doing in heaven? Luke 15. They're having a big party. There's rejoicing in heaven over one sinner that repents, because they realize they've come back into the purpose and plan of God. You're in your sin and pleasing yourself. You're out of the purpose, what you are called to be. So through Jesus Christ, we have hope. Through Jesus Christ, we have one who took our sin. He took our hell. He took our death. He took all of our darkness, and now we have heaven, forgiveness, life, light. We have everything that pertains to life and godliness. This is the offer of the gospel. This is a day of good news. So repent and believe the gospel. This is an emergency day. Wake up, everybody. There's an emergency on. Eternity. Eternity is the destiny. Without Christ, you will die in your sins. Reality stand of God, hell, the world, and me. We need to repent. We need to be set for life. We need to be set for the life that is true life. Now and forever. Forever we have eternal life with God. And now we have the life that God ordains for us, which is the life of purpose and meaning. And it's all the confusion. And there's plenty of that around, isn't there? You younger ones. Don't wait. Don't wait. Go for Christ now. And you older ones, don't wait. Don't wait. We do not know what a day will bring, for God has ordained for us that we would have life, full life, through Jesus Christ. So How do I come into this way, this repentance way, this I'm sorry, I've done wrong, please forgive me way? Let's go to verse 7, verse 17 of our passage. Come to verse 17. What is the way? Verse 17 of Psalm 51. The word reads, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. Oh God, you will not despise. There's one way into the departure lounge for heaven, and that is the crushed and broken, repentant way. When you go to the airport, many of us have probably done, we will all have to go one way in order to get onto the aeroplane. We will all have to go through the entrance, which takes us through into the departure gates. And you will see it signposted, departures. You go through security and you have all your baggage checked. That is the only way to get onto the aeroplane. There is no other way. You could choose, of course, to try and bypass security and dodge things by going in through some external access and climbing a fence, but you'll be stopped and you will not have the relevant documentation to get on the aeroplane. Who will come into the blessings of God? Who will come into life? Who will come into this way? It is those of verse 17, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. Oh God, you will not despise. And David obviously is speaking from experience. Psalm 51, as we have already mentioned, is a repentant psalm. Psalm 51 is in the context of David in 2 Samuel in chapter 11 doing what? Breaking the Ten Commandments. Quite a lot of them, probably. He had somebody murdered for a start off. Also committed adultery. Bit of stealing involved there as well. Bit of coveting. Lots of Ten Commandments collapsing before David's sin. Exposed he was. What happened? Didn't seem to bother for quite a long time, did he? Getting on with his life, even though he'd been involved in all of this crime before God, until a man turned up, Nathan the prophet. Nathan the prophet told David a story, about this man. He was really quite rich. And he had lots of animals in his on his farm, and he was doing well. And there was another very poor man who just had one lamb, and he cared for this lamb, that poor man, so much as one of his family. And one day, the visitor came to the rich man, and the rich man was thinking, "Well, how do I provide for this man who's come to visit?" What did he do? He took one from the poor man, the only one from the poor man. And David is outraged when he hears about this. How could that happen? And Nathan says, "You're the man. That is you, David. You have acted in an outrageous way, tearing away that which belongs to you." David is, as the word of God has come through Nathan, he is broken. And Psalm 51 is the brokenness psalm, the repentant psalm that ensued. He realized, verse 4, against you only have I sinned and done evil in your sight. Verse 5, behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. It's all about the realization of who he is before God. We start to get wise. We start to get thinking as we should do when we start to think in God's way and not our way. That's what David was doing. David is saying in Psalm 51, this is now I'm thinking properly. This is I'm thinking properly now because I see sin for what it is. And he realizes the only true way of back to God is when you are broken, broken, broken before God. So David is a convicted man. So what does it say? It's about being broken in your heart. Where's your heart? Anybody want to get their heart out to show me? Well, it's not your literal heart. It is the indication of that which is the center of your being, your thinking and your loving and your feeling. It's the heart of what makes you keep going. You go to a ship and you think, well, how does this ship keep going across the waters? And somebody will say, well, it's the engine room. The heart is the engine room of our lives. So he's basically saying he's broken in the very heart of his being. It's full of contrition. What is contrition? It's just realizing you've just gone the wrong way. You've messed up. You've completely made a disaster of life. And he's completely broken. Isaiah, we read these passages. Isaiah 57, verse 15, we read, for thus says the one who is high and lifted up, who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in the high and holy place, and also with him who is of a contrite and lowly spirit, to revive the spirit of the lowly, and to revive the heart of the contrite. The promise of God is to come and bring life into the broken and the contrite. And Isaiah 66, we read, thus says the Lord, heaven is my throne. God is established where he is set to be by his own sovereign right. Heaven is my throne, he says, and the earth is my footstool. What is the house that you would build for me? And what is the place of my rest? All these things my hand has made. And so all these things came to be, declares the Lord. But this is the one to whom I look, he who is humble and contrite in spirit and trembles at my word. David has trembled before the word of God brought by me. We have the word of God, everybody. We tremble before the word of God because it reveals to God who is on the throne, the Almighty, ever living, everlasting God. But we seek to do what? We seek to bring other hearts. We seek to bring our ritual performing hearts, our religious performance hearts, our go along to church and do my religious bit hearts, or go to whatever religion takes your fancy kind of hearts. And we think, well, God will be pleased with that. And no, he isn't, because it's a broken, a contrite heart he's pleased with. And some of us, we bring our, I'm really quite a decent person kind of hearts. You know, I'm a person of good standing. Ask my neighbors. They'll probably say I'm okay. God says, Your standing is in sin before me. You are warped in your understanding if you think you can stand on your own before God. We can only stand before God in Christ. When you stand in Christ, you stand in glory. Accept. It's amazing. And some of us, we think we'll bring our, what, heart? Oh, our good works heart, don't we? A few good works, you know. My achievements. God will surely be pleased with my achievements. And God says, all your righteousness is all filthy rags. That's what God says. And God says, you come my way. Do you remember when David was first declared that he would be the ruler over Israel? Samuel had been told that the coming ruler to replace Saul would be in the household of Jesse. So he turns up at Jesse's household and he seeks out the coming king. Seeks out the coming king. And so Jesse brings them all along. Brings out number one, Eliab. Number two. Number one wasn't the one. Number two, Abinadab. Not him. Number three, Shammah. Wasn't him either. Four more came. It wasn't them. They were not set to be king. What's going on then? Where is the king? And they say, well, there's one out in the field. He's the youngest and he's looking after the sheep. And obviously the inference was, it can't be that one. He's just not up to it. And he comes in. David comes in. Young, fresh. They considered him not the one, but God said he is the one. He is the one to be king. He is the one I recognize. I do not despise him at all. You may despise him, but I do not despise him. People may say to you, don't be serious about your sin. We're in 2020 now. We've all matured and we're all improving. That story gets harder to swallow by the day, doesn't it? As we see what is happening in society around us and how people turn on each other. I had a sad happening this week. Revealed a lot to me. One of our neighbors was moving, and there was a big fallout with the other next door neighbor over a fence. A real fallout with fruity language and all that kind of stuff over the fence. So sad. I found it so sad. They just departed. Bad terms. Turned against each other. Society, that's life, isn't it? Where am I going? I'm going to this. I'm going to focus upon this. We are wise when we go into this place, when we realize we are those who are broken and contrite, not because we have manipulated our thinking, but because we have seen it as God sees it. We've seen our lives as God sees them. We've come and we're trembling before God. None of our good works. Stuff else you might want to dig out of your life. None of it will cut the mustard. It will all be hopeless and helpless. It is only broken. And whose welcome do you want? It's the welcome of God that we should want. So David here is getting it right. Are we getting it right this morning? Are we coming, realizing that we are like David? We sinned in the presence of God. And we need God. We need help. Here is the repentant one. We've seen, if we cast our eyes up to verse 16, now he says that God does not delight in sacrifices, or he would give it. You will not be pleased with a burnt offering. Notice that is the best offerings that could have been brought. Those are not going to do the issue because the heart is wrong. The heart has to be in the right place. The heart has to be broken before God. The work of God's word to bring conviction for our sin. And then we might say in the last two verses, we see everything opening up. We almost see David start to live, start to see life. He enters into an awareness of God's place and God's purpose. As he says in verse 18, do good to Zion in your good pleasure. Build up the walls of Jerusalem. It's as if life starts to dawn. God's purpose is the purpose that matters. God's place is the place that matters. God's people are the people that matter. And his whole being is being renewed. And he's coming into verse 19 and he's seeing the sacrifice. You see, the sacrifice now has meaning because the heart has been renewed. The heart is renewed when the heart is broken. And the heart has nothing to offer. God says, I can take that kind of heart. I'll have that heart. And you say, I want to keep my heart. And I say, you'll keep it to your death. And you'll keep it into your hell. Give up your heart. Hand over the lock and key to the God who made you. Find it, because it's there. So will you come? The sacrifice emerges. Oh, how rich this is, as he delights in the right sacrifice. So we see much down the ages. David, a thousand years, wouldn't have seen it fully, but in the understanding of the things at the time, he's going to realize the true sacrifice now comes with the right heart. And he comes to see that we can see today in Jesus Christ. We have the final full sacrifice. We see on Calvary's cross that everything that was anticipated in the Old Testament is fulfilled. And so he comes to delight in this sacrifice. You done any delighting this week? Oh, how precious it was this morning to be delighting at the Lord's Supper in the sacrifice. And in the Savior, and in the glories of him who has come to rescue us. In burnt offerings and whole burnt offering, then bulls will be offered on your altar. Feltham, Evangelical Church, dear beloved church here, is it the case that we are being hindered in our worship? Hindered in our delight in Christ because we are carrying the wrong hearts. The hearts that came to salvation with brokenness and contrition have become taken over by other inclinations. And we're not delighting in the sacrifice. We're not loving the Savior. We're not consecrated into seeing God's great purpose in his place and in his people. This is life, you see. It's where it is found. It's found where God ordains that it would be found. So are you repentant? really repentance? It is the way to life. It is the way into knowing Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. John the Baptist became declaring repentance, clearing the ground. The Lord Jesus came with the great fulfillment of faith to go into all of those lives broken up by the ministry of John the Baptist. What is your cry this morning? What is my cry before the God who is God and eternally holy? Do we come like that Pharisee in Luke 17 who says, "I thank you, O God, that I'm not like other men, even this tax collector, the way of faith, the way of blessing, the way of the tax collector, and simply cry out, God, accept me on the basis of the sacrifice that this man went down, accepted by God." This is the gospel. This is the good news. This is life. I say again, God, hell, this world, you and me, realities, how do we respond? Where do we go? Will we go in the way of repentance? There's only one way. Into the departure lounge for blessing. And that is the way established by God. I say go. I say enter in. Fellow believers, perhaps it's a day where we go back and our hearts are once again torn up. We once again savor the oil poured in of Calvary's cross, shed blood for the forgiveness of our sins, acceptance with God. And you say then, how should I live? And I say, then you will live. Then you will live. All other life is deception. This is real life. The anointing of God to go now and to live out his life with the Holy Spirit poured upon us. Acknowledging God, seeing where I am, loving those around us, entering into the word to see God's purpose in his place and in his people, and seeking to reach out to bring others into his place and into his people, and touching the people of God to encourage them into his place and to be his people, that they might grow and prosper. And so the repentant ones are the going ones, are the living ones. And it's amazing grace that even includes a wretch like me who sinned and is miserable. And it's amazing that I can say, by grace I have been saved through faith. And that not of myself. It's the gift of God. So even somebody as bad as me, and if there's somebody out there who's not yet aware of their sin, see God. See yourself. And turn. And live. And live. And live. Forever. And ever and ever. Amen. Amen. So can it really be? Can it really?